Okay, quick background about this topic itself. Mindful life planning. So I'll be sharing some of my own personal experience because some of the things I went through in my own life and career. More than that, as I have been coaching a lot of managers and leaders in various organizations, we have seen a lot of patterns which are very similar, which essentially relates to a lot more of dealing with one's own life rather than just the professional aspects, which impacts the professional life in turn actually. And a lot of times people hesitate to talk about that because it's something a little bit more personal. And especially in the organization context, people hesitate that that will be seen as a weakness or a vulnerability, and they want to not to reveal that. And they fear they will be judged. They'll be seen as underperformer because of that, etc. So we have seen a lot of people approach in a very secretive way, and we do one-on-one coaching on that on a pro bono basis a lot of times. And invariably, it's more of a life coaching. So I thought, why not share that? And it could be useful for many more people. So thanks to Jagdish for suggesting that. So that's why we are here now. A quick background about myself. By profession, I'm an electronics communication engineer and did certain masters in computer science courses in IISc, and then worked in IISc for a couple of years on research projects. Then worked in ADA for 7 years on the light combat aircraft avionics system. That's where we met Sam first. Then worked in Motorola for about 8 years. Again, Sam was also there in Motorola at that time. Among that, 3 years I was in Singapore covering the Asia-Pacific region, Japan, Korea, China, Singapore, and India on a software excellence journey. After coming back, I joined Mindtree. It was a startup. I was senior VP and part of the core management team. I was with Mindtree for about 9 years, taking it from a startup to, 10,000 people global organization. And then we wanted to do something on our own. So we started PM Power Consulting along with other colleagues whom we knew through the industry. And that's what continues now. We're engaged with a lot of agile transformation, leadership development, multiple aspects of coaching. This is on the professional side. A few things on the personal side or interests, which also relates to all these things. I like Hindustani classical music. I play tabla. I used to do a lot of gymnastics. Roman rings and parallel bars were my favorite. College represented college in that. I love mountains. I do a lot of trekking, mountaineering. It continues. My eldest brother is a homeopathic doctor, so I got interested and studied homeopathy. In that process, I learned a lot about human anatomy, physiology, neurology, endocrinology, psychology, because these are the core aspects to diagnose a human being. And I see when you talk about leadership, essentially all these things come together. And I'm an ardent practitioner of yoga, meditation since many decades. And I have seen tremendous impact of that on myself and even people around me actually. So I thought all these things connect together when you talk about leadership, because leadership is essentially about dealing with this wonderful machine that we have called body, mind, and energy. So that's the context or the background. So now I want to do a quick poll to get an idea of the class. So Malavika will be launching the poll. I would like you to respond what age bracket you belong to.
Yeah, Vishu, we have all the results in. Should I share?
Yeah, share. Okay. This is good. I think this presentation is a little bit more tuned for the age between 30 to 50. So above 50 people are on my side now. You are all the coaches because you are all overqualified, as I said.
Hey, Viju, I'm very young.
That's why I said, how old are you? What's the age? So I didn't ask, how old are you? Yeah, thank you for that.
Vasudev, I'm the youngest. I'm less than 25.
yes. Thank you, Sam.
Yeah.
Yes,
so how we can look at this? No. It's an interactive session today. So please chip in anytime and also ask questions as we go along. And if that is a debatable question, we'll take it at the end. But if it's kind of a clarifying kind of questions, we'll address it at that time. How I would like you to look at this session is that since many of you are kind of have gone through good amount of life experiences, look at this as a possible way to take it to many more people. And you can help as well many more people with some of these inputs. I'm sure there is so much wisdom with all of you people, but this could add in terms of putting some things in another way of looking at things. So thank you for joining, all of you. So can you stop sharing? How do I do that? Yeah. So now let's get on with that. This is how we see how people look at growth in an organization or in their career, in whichever field they are in. Normally they start with as an individual contributor, where doing is the most important part. As long as they are individually very good at doing something, they will be a high performer. And as long as they have some technical skills, domain skills in that area, they'll be a high performer. And this requires IQ, which is, you know, all about information, knowledge, thinking, analysis, those kind of things. But as they grow, the next stage is typically about leading a set of people, managing a set of people, which is a very different ballgame. So from doing to shifting to getting things done is a very big transition. And in most companies, we don't see that people are made ready for that. They just get pushed. For example, high performer here gets promoted to next stage. But a high IQ manager will be struggling with that because this is all about EQ, emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence is about self-awareness, empathy, self-regulation, motivation. So basically people dealing with a lot of people, other people as well as oneself. And when they move up further, which is more of a middle management, which is a really a struggle zone where the matrix structure of the organization comes into play. They have to influence the peers who don't report to them. And it's like managing the managers. So this requires even more higher order of emotional intelligence. And as they grow further, what is called senior leadership, the challenge here is about how to bring alignment and integration at this level, because there'll be conflict of shared accountability, shared responsibility, how to bring alignment and shared vision in people. And tremendous amount of energy and drive, because from this top, they have to make things happen at the bottom here, because real things happen only at the bottom, the shop floor. This requires mindfulness quotient, which is about tremendous inner, you know, competency, dealing with one's own mind, body, energy, emotions, all those kind of things. And these growths are not linear. It's not a straight line. So we call this as S-curves. So people start with something and they become very good at that. And if they continue to do more of the same, then there is a stagnation starts happening. And if they further continue that, then there'll be a point of degeneration. They will be very less effective in doing that. They will lose motivation, interest. Before that happens, people should start their next S-curve, which is typically a point of discontinuity. That means they have to leave something which they are good at and pick up something which is new. And these are very difficult because it's very scary. And it also looks like I'm actually going down. It's a demotion rather than a promotion. Looks like that. So, you know, it's like in a circus, leaving this swing and catching the other swing. It's like that. So people need a lot of help in these transitions. That's what we notice. It is true not only for professional dimension, even in personal lives, people go through S-curves. And we can notice many things, you know, in our own life stages. For example, when people get married, it's a very big shift in terms of, you know, way of life and living together with, you know, other persons. And when baby comes in their family, it's another big shift. And when parents get their children married, that's another big shift. And when we lose our parents, that's another big shift. So a lot of such kind of shifts, life forces upon us in a sense. And if you understand and actually navigate it through proactively, we can sail through or flow in a much better way rather than getting hit or feel like compulsively pushed. So that's why I just wanted to relate this growth curves, where we should be able to observe ourselves, where are we in this kind of S curves, and how should I be shifting to my next S curve. And especially in the midlife, that's why I said from 30 to 50 age, but not necessarily it ends there. We may encounter it multiple times. Midlife issues, because we encounter a lot of managers and leaders in those stages. It's a confused state in life on crossroads. So a lot of physiological changes happen, hormonal changes, physical systems slowing down, mood swings, etc. And we notice a lot of managers and leaders struggle with this, but they think that it's only they are going through that and they want to hide it. In fact, I went through myself. The moment they realize or come to know that it's everybody is going through that, that itself reduces that burden, 50% of it. And during this midlife, they also go through certain stages in the family. Typically, we see the people at this stage have young children and aging parents, and they are in the middle in their life stage. And they are also in the middle in the organization, typically, the middle management, which is a heavy stress zone. They have pressure from the top, pressure from the bottom, the team members demanding, peer competition, peer pressures. So it's really a traffic junction. They're also in certain financial state by this time in most of the industries. So the questions start popping up. What is the purpose of life? What am I doing here? What's the real, you know, most important thing I should be doing? You know, that kind of questions. And again, we see this with so many managers. And in fact, in our first coaching interactions, it doesn't come up. They gradually open up and then we really see that this is the real thing which is bothering inside actually. And it reflects as if it's in the professional life is the issue. And in fact, there are a lot of research done and shows that there are history of highest and dramatic career shifts. Because at this stage, people just want to jump out of that. They don't know this is not the right thing that's happening. I just want to, you know, do something else. In fact, I myself had thought, it's about 12 years back, that I wanted to start a adventure school in Western Ghats, which is totally, it's just a dream, but I'm sure I wouldn't have been able to do that. Luckily, I had a coach called Shubhrata Bakshi in Mindtree at that time, and he brought me some senses. And there are also histories of highest divorces at this stage, because both parties are struggling with that. So it's important that they understand that it's just a passing period, and they need to navigate through this, you know, turbulence. And imagine the plight of such people and the plight of people working with them in an organization context. In fact, for me, I was a senior VP in Mindtree, 100 people with me directly in my team. And I was responsible for a function for a 10,000 people global organization. And I was visionless. I was in this confused state that what is all these things? Why I'm doing all these things? Now imagine I have to lead those people with certain shared vision and drive and create motivation, energy in them. But I myself is lacking all that things. That was the kind of situation. And this is not that. Yeah.
I mean, there's a presumption here in these slides earlier and here that you know, management is the path. So like management is one of the domains.
Yes.
You could be, you know, your S-curve could be along, like you want to be a subject matter leader, not a people leader.
Yeah.
Or a business leader. So there are different paths and then there could be different challenges.
Yes, yes.
So for very good. In your, you know, while you were saying the aerospace world, if you had decided to be a subject matter expert in the aerospace and moved along that path, then it would be a different set of thinking, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's a very good point you brought up. Even though I talked about management or managing people kind of aspect, these S-curves hold good even for technical people. For example, I want to be an architect. I don't want to deal with people, etc. Individual contributor. I just want to be an individual contributor. Even for them, it very much holds good because as you move up, expectation is that you impact larger set of people, influence larger set of people. So for that, you need all those kind of things, emotional intelligence, mindfulness quotient, etc. Otherwise, you can't do that. So even whichever path you take as a growth, all those things are required. Thank you for bringing that. Yes. So these aspects are not addressed in the organization. I'm quoting Subrata Bakhji here from his book, Go Kiss the World. So there is what's called professional issues, which the organizations address. There are certain personal issues. So we leave it for the individuals to deal with. There is certain personal professional issues which impact the oneself as well as the other people in the organization. And they are not dealt with. This is what we see in our coaching, that people are struggling with, which they don't want to discuss in an organization context. And they want to keep it secret, otherwise they'll be judged wrongly, etc. Which is the topic I'm bringing up further down. So a little bit more of this midlife issues. Really, people are seeking here the purpose and they need highest level of mentoring and coaching. Again, what we notice in organization is that managers and leaders think that teams need a lot of coaching. Teams need to be improved. We see that managers and leaders need the biggest coaching. In fact, one of the things I learned from Subrata Bakhji is also is that high performers need highest coaching. Conventionally, we think low performers need coaching. On the contrary, it's the high performers need highest coaching because they are running so fast, they hit the dead end very fast, actually. They hit their S-curves very quickly. And if they are not able to do that, they will collapse. We have seen a lot of high performers just collapse. Suddenly, they come to a dead end. That's because they are running so fast that they're not looking at the big picture of life and the purpose and larger vision aspects. So the transition, again, quoting from Subrata Bakhji, in the ages 20s, who I want to be, you know, I want to become this, I want to become that, I want, you know, that kind of a dream, aspirations, etc. Then at age 30s, people start realizing who am I? Oh, I'm a manager, I am a good at technical, I am maybe a coach, you know, whatever. And at age 40s, even more reality dawns. Then they say, who am I really meant to be? This is where realistic alignments start happening. Who am I as a person as a characteristic person with certain values, principles, and characteristics, and what is best for me to do, that kind of realization. And if people kind of figure that out, there will be a lot of harmony. Otherwise, there will be a lot of conflicts within themselves and what they are doing. So people here need life path beyond career path. And that's what we see when we do coaching of managers and leaders. In fact, they are looking for that. When that life path becomes clear, their career path automatically takes care. And they actually become good performers in that. I'm giving quite a bit of references. I'll be sharing this presentation later. You can look up them. This is one of the videos by Dan Pink. Many people might have seen this. What motivates people? Really, what motivates people is the purpose. You know, why I'm doing what I'm doing. So, again, referring to Subrata Bakshi, one of the talks he gave in a convocation ceremony, and he has written an article on that. I have given a reference here. There is a platform and a purpose. Platform is essentially about our body, mind, that means our health, education, our level of experience, our network, the people we are, you know, connected with, our net worth, which is more of a financial status, our family. All this put together is like our platform. And purpose is actually on this platform, or on using this platform, what do you want to contribute to this world? That is really the purpose. So there are four quadrants emerging in this: low platform, low purpose. You know, somebody who is struggling even to make a living, that's like a low platform. And they will be so bogged down for a day-to-day living, their purpose could be low, just the survival. And there could be some people who are low platform, but high purpose. They have a high dream, high vision, high ambition, but they have low platform. They cannot achieve that. They cannot do much actually. But what we encounter in our industry is mostly people in this zone: high platform, low purpose. They have all of this. If you look at this platform, you know, they are doing gym exercises, keeping fit, many of them at least, good education, experience, good network, family, all of thing is there, but lacking is purpose. So from moving from here to high platform, high purpose is the crossing the chasm. You know, how do I go there? That is exploring, what do you really want to do? What is my life vision? Not just the professional career. And we have seen people who get clarity on their life path perform better. They feel more secure and they collaborate better because they have less insecurity, and they develop other people better. And so how to go there? Again, this is two-dimensional matrix here. You know, on one side challenge, one side skills. You might have come across this. This is another popular psychological model used in industries. If you have high challenge and low skills, we start experiencing anxiety, burnout, fear, you know, and we can't perform much. At the same time, we have very good skills, but low challenge, we get boredom, stagnation. So really where we want to be or should be is this middle zone, which is called zone of flow. So if we can constantly operate this, that means increase our skill, take up higher challenge, increase our skill, take up higher challenge. So we'll be in a zone of flow. And that leads to growth, expansion, evolution. And when I say skills here, it's not about some technical managerial kind of skills. It's more importantly, even the life skill. Because if you have to navigate this way, we need a life skill actually. And again, I have given one blog that I have written. You can look up in this. To go in this zone of flow, it's not so much about controlling people, controlling situations, controlling oneself. it's actually letting go and accepting and go with the flow, really, as things emerge in the life. I have really seen that it really works. But many times we are educated to think the other way. You know, I have to control everything. So it's counterintuitive because we are not educated in certain ways. So I would invite you to explore this aspect. And when you're in zone of flow, it's really joyful. You enjoy whatever you do in life, actually. And when you are enjoying in whatever we are doing, we'll be contributing highest in that, actually. So if you have to be in this zone of flow, we need to look at this wholesome life. There is professional life, which you all understand. There is family and social life. And there is personal and spiritual life. When I say personal spiritual life, this includes one's own health, well-being, all those aspects. And when I say spiritual, I'm not talking about so much of religious things, but it's more about managing our own body, mind, energy. And in fact, going beyond that, that is really spiritual, but it is kind of out of syllabus for this session. So if you look at, we see that, right? If the professional life is not good, it also affects our family and social life. And if our family and social life is not good, it also affects our professional life. And vice versa. If they are good, they affect both of us in a positive way. Similarly, if the health is not good, or if our mind is not in a steady state, it helps all other lives. So all these three mutually reinforce each other. In fact, even professional life and family social life, if it is good, even your spiritual life will be good. Otherwise, for example, if you want to meditate, you sit for meditation, it will cloud. Mind will get clouded with all these things. So that's how I see all these three mutually reinforce. And again, my personal experience is that as we evolve, probably you will notice that all these three are not really different. It's in our Vishnu, initial...
Can I give you a small input in this case?
Okay.
Because it's a very surprising for many people to know.
Yeah.
I was once a soldier. I was an Air Force officer.
Yeah.
What I found in military is right from the beginning, most of the military belongs to the very young people below 35 years of age. Mm. Therefore, always the commanders are taught, then they tell their people below them that you must have a very clean life.
Mm.
Otherwise, your profession, your family, your personal, all things will get screwed up. Therefore, this is something which has been taught to regularly to them. That is why the so many people come out of armed forces every year. Nearly 50,000 people. Almost all the people quietly get into the life.
Yeah.
And you don't find many spoiled military people outside.
Yeah.
This is one of the things at a very young age, from the age of 17, they are taught this. I just wanted to share this with you. There is one big institution which teaches this as a routine.
Wonderful, Sam. I think I have seen, in fact, one of my nephew was in army, and he took after 7 years, change. I see that they are extremely disciplined in their life, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
But if I'm just along those lines, you know, you had this slide, a couple of that, two, three slides back, where you just said that age, I forget what that, 20, 30, 40. So what I meant to be, do people have to realize that, do they need to be in the army?
No.
Or if you're not in the army, what do you do? How do you, why do you need to start realizing what I meant to be at 40 beyond?
No, see, it's also, I'll come to that in the next slides. Lot of that is also related to our education and upbringing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's why we are postponing discovering ourselves so late, which should have been the first step in our life, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm coming to a spreadsheet that we use to help people on this, this three-dimensional balancing, basically. In fact, I found it personally useful for myself. In fact, about 12 years back, I went through my own churn. 2 years, I struggled with what is my purpose of life and really what should I be doing, most important thing to do in life, etc. Then I kind of put it on a spreadsheet like this, these three dimensions. And in most of my coaching, I use it with coaches and they find it very useful. This professional life, you know, what I want to do. So here is basically you plot an year from this year to say some many years and age, your age, your spouse age, parents age, children age, you just plot them along this year axis. And then what stage all of them will be at different, you know, years. And then you map your professional life. So at various stages, what should I be really doing? And map the spiritual path as well. Your interest, hobbies, I put yoga, Advaita, etc. No? Ultimately, it's about, you know, realizing something. Whatever is your thinking and interest. And look at all these things and the intensity of this may vary. For example, here, professional life is a very high intensity here. I gradually reduce. And maybe I'll then increase my personal, spiritual or interests and life, something like that. So you can actually plan something like a long horizon and also think about what's my life vision and orient towards that so that whatever you do in all these three dimensions of life, it is leading you towards that so that then you can navigate your S-curve smoothly. Otherwise, life will actually push you because life situations and people that come across for us all are meant for making us to evolve. And many times we don't realize that. We think they are a problem. So with this, actually, we can proactively deal with that. That's what I have felt. So I'll share this spreadsheet also so you can then see whatever is useful for you. Or you can share it with others as well. And in fact, you can help children also in this, gradually, not directly teaching them something, but helping them to realize these three dimensions. And you can help parents also. I'll come to that in the next slide. So if you look at this kind of a life stage, if you plan, it really comes to the life stages, which is beautifully, you know, dealt with in the Indian wisdom traditions. You know, we used to have balya, playful exploration of and understanding of nature. And then brahmacharya, which was essentially to discover and develop our inner mastery. And then grahastha, which is go out and manage or do good to the world with this inner mastery. And then vanaprastha, which is relinquish or hand over this to the next generation and explore higher dimensions. And then sannyasa, which is prepare the soul and soul journey, because we come alone and then we come go alone, right? So that will be very smooth instead of a struggle. And we realize that that is not, many times we think death is a bad thing. And we really realize by this that it's just a change of status. So then it's not a struggle. This is a very beautiful life cycle stages. But what has happened is we're caught up with the, you know, whatever has happened in the world. People come to this discovering inner mastery at the ages of 40 and above, where in leadership sessions we are doing how to develop inner mastery. Because all along the education has been moment schooling starts, it's all about external things, you know, acquiring knowledge, gathering information, storing memory, dealing with external things. Very little about dealing with oneself, how to manage myself. That is not taught at all. And that is the most precious thing. In fact, there are many things. I won't go into the detail. Until the age of 80, I mean, age of 8, actually children have a very high intuitive intelligence. In fact, they can perceive much more than adults. But because we are, you know, conditioned and educated in a wrong way, we don't think that way. In fact, there are many processes to keep that intuition process alive in the Indian system. That's how through Brahmacharya they developed that. And intuitive intelligence in the modern now management things is coming up as a very important dimension. Earlier people thought high IQ is most important. Then people said, oh, EQ is more important than IQ. Then now people are saying intuitive intelligence is even more powerful. And that's what children have, and we kill them. In fact, this is a beautiful process. If you look at that that spreadsheet I showed you, in fact, it actually flows like that. So if you look at this way, then you can help children as well as parents in this whole life cycle stages, as well as look at your own, you know, career path or life path, I would say.
Vishu, if I may say, this is really good, even the slide prior. If you have to map best practices for these life stages, mm-hmm. people probably also know which are the best practices to use in which phase.
There is so much.
you should be taking parent-student meetings in schools, Vishu. Thank
you. In fact,
you.
We are in some places we are doing this. It's actually triangle. Students, teachers, and parents. That triangle needs to be addressed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So, what's the time now? 43. I want to leave some time for questions. Wholesome lives through inner mastery. So if you want to really manage this way, it requires certain inner skills, inner mastery. Otherwise, we miss that. That's where we see mindfulness is actually coming back into corporate world. This is our mindfulness framework, mindful leadership framework. We say managing outside by mastering inside. The more complex situations and people you have to deal with outside, you need more inner mastery. How to manage our own emotions, our own energies, our own thinking, our own mind. That's all about inner mastery. More we have the inner mastery, we can deal with external people and situations much more effectively. So in that context, shall we do one small activity? Because we have been just listening. And as I said, these are all beyond just our intellectual thinking. The more we silence our mind, we get these intuitive dimensions much better. And that will get us much more clarity on our life vision and life path. Even in earlier sessions, we have done this small activity, 4 minutes. And of course, then you can explore. Even though it's a very simple technique, if you really go deep, this one thing itself is sufficient to get us to the highest level of awareness. Are you all okay? Shall we? So what I want you to do now is I will play a set of guided instructions. You just sit relaxed with your back and head straight, and then follow the instructions. Okay?
Sure, thanks.
I'll have to enable the audio. Okay. So just sit relaxed. Loosen your shoulders, neck, because that's where the stiffness happens if you notice. Keep your head and back straight because that helps. And just follow this instruction. Close your eyes and just follow this instruction. Sit relaxed,
with your back and head straight. Close your eyes. Bring your attention to the breath. Start observing your breath. Breathe slowly and deeply with full inhalation and full exhalation. Keep observing the breath. Observe the sensations in the nostrils as you breathe in and breathe out. Observe the slight movement of the nostrils as you breathe in and breathe out. Observe the movement of chest and abdomen as you breathe in and breathe out. Continue to observe the breath. If any thoughts come, don't follow the thoughts. Gently bring back the attention to the breath. Continue to observe the breath. Slowly and gently open your eyes.
Okay, welcome back. So you feel a little bit quietening, relaxed. So I would recommend that you experiment those things. The more our mind is calm, we get more deeper intuitive ideas, thoughts, vision. You know, just try it out. So I'll take a few, 2-3 slides, and then I'll open up for questions and discussion. I'm going little one more step on this life purpose, because that is the one which actually then aligns everything else for us. Again, going back to Indian system, there is a wonderful service model in Indian system. Annadana, you know, donate food, money, etc. for less privileged. So help people to live for a few more days. So more, I would say, I won't say relative. Another level of service is jivadana, like doctor, nurses, the healthcare. Help people on health, well-being, you know, help people to live for longer, right? Above that is more like vidyadana, which is like teachers, help people to stand their own feet. So you teach them so that they can take care of their anna and jiva. You know, it is, this is a lot more precious that way. But in the modern age, teachers are the, you know, least. That's the last job, kind of. Even more powerful than that is jnanadana, like guru, help people realize who they really are and what life is. So this is not just for one life. This can help them to, you know, lifetimes, many lifetimes. So this is a wonderful service model in Indian system. And we can actually try to see what is the best fit for my life vision, because giving is the best way to get. In fact, there are so much research all over the world. The most accomplished people, you know, rich and famous. In fact, Harvard has run a many years of project. They have interviewed people at the, you know, their end time. And people have come back and said, even though they have been such rich and famous, they say, I wasted my life. That's too late to realize. So, I mean, we can actually see there is a much powerful way of, or a more fulfilling way of making our life more holistic. And if you look at this model versus Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which in the management and modern education, we come across this more than the Indian systems, starting from the physiological needs to going up to the self-actualization. You know, Maslow was a psychologist, US psychologist in around 1900 to 1970 or something like that. So that's basically looking at what's the purpose of life. And many times as people move up in their career, as their financial stability improves, they start looking at, so what should I really be doing? You know, what's the real purpose? So this could give some answers for that. I'll go one more step deeper. This is the highest. In fact, I talked about 12 years back, I was struggling with what's the real purpose of life. And one day I went to Ramakrishna Ashram and I saw this tagline in the Ramakrishna Ashram, Atmano Mokshartam Jagad Hitaya Cha. Even though I was a student from Ramakrishna Ashram, it had not hit me. And it really hit me. This is from Rig Veda. And Swami Vivekananda made it as the motto of Ramakrishna Mission. What it means is Atmano Mokshartam. This is one statement which is defined as purpose of life. One's own self-realization, realize who we really are, and do good to the world, people and the whole planet. It's so comprehensive, not just people, it's actually the whole planet. Jagat includes animals, plants, everything. And this is the real big purpose of life. So everything else, our careers, family, social life, all other things are to support for this actually. So if you get this kind of a big picture view of the life vision, my own personal experience is that there is so much harmony comes into life. Because this is the soul struggle actually. And it manifests as our external physical existential struggles. With that, I will be closing. I'll give one more reference for reading. He's again, thanks to Jagdish, who introduced me to Suresh about 5 years back. He's a serial entrepreneur based in US, a Bangalorean basically. But he's a, I would say, enlightened being. And he has written a book called Just Be. It's a wonderful book. It has the real essence of the world's wisdom traditions without any of the jargons of scriptures and anything. It's very good for the modern context. And it addresses personal, professional, social issues and up to the highest spiritual possibilities. Lot of practical techniques and tips. So after this session, if you want to just pursue one more step of exploration, I would suggest this video. It's a 30-minute video of his interview. I'll close with my last picture, which is, I drew this picture about 20 years back as a reminder for myself about this wholesome life, balancing the all the three dimensions of life. The fishermen on this ocean represent the professional life, you know, making a living, earning and, you know, making a living. And the on the shore here, you won't see this in picture properly. There are huts and village. It's actually about family and social life. And the sky and the light, they represent the spiritual life. And the yin yang here is the balance. And that's what brings the wholesome life. And many times I feel pictures stay in mind and communicate powerfully. So I thought I'll just leave this, you know, impression or the thought with you. So with that, I'll close and open up for questions, discussions, and I'll be sharing this presentation. And you can always approach us. You can write to us anytime. And I would also request any topics of interest for the future in terms of, you know, how to deal with certain things, how to deal with anger or how to deal with depression or how to deal with certain things in professional or what I called as personal professional, that zones. You can write to me or Malavika and we'll see how we can, you know, structure some of the future topics.